Thank you for being here tonight, and welcome to the Delaware County Republican Party's candidate forum for House District Number 5. We have three remarkable men who are vying for this position tonight. So this is an important night for us. We have a series of questions. I guess I should tell you, first of all, who I am. I'm Pastor Robert Carter, and I have the privilege of serving as the Delaware County Chairman of the Republican Party. And I'll be moderating the debate and not asking the questions. I am assisted by Mr. Rick Flood, who's our Vice Chairman, and his lovely wife, Cheryl Flood. So I am between two floods tonight. Someone said that makes me Noah, so. We are thrilled to get that you're here this evening. And I want to just, we're going to open with a word of prayer and a pledge, and then I want to go through how we're going to work the forum tonight. So I've asked my dear friend, Pastor Dave Knox, if he would lead us in the opening prayer tonight.
Would you bow your head with me? Heavenly Father, we come before you tonight so appreciative of this country we are privileged to live in. We thank you for the process that we have here tonight, that we can freely voice our opinions. God, we just ask for your spirit of unity to be here tonight. God, thank you for all those involved. We thank you, God, for clarity of mind. We thank you for peace that passes understanding, resting upon each candidate, upon the moderators. And Father, we just thank you for this facility that's been provided tonight. God, may everything that's done tonight, may it bring your kingdom glory and honor. In your mighty name we pray. Amen.
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 If I could ask you to stand and join us with the Pledge of Allegiance. Ready? Salute. Pledge.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. You may be seated. So the format this evening may look a little familiar to you if you watched any of the Republican debates. I'm not calling this a debate as much as we're calling it a candidate forum, because our goal tonight is to give them the opportunity to get as much information out about who they are and what their stances are on the various issues. So we will encourage them to just to share as much as they can with you tonight. And the questions that we have will cover a pretty broad range of topics. I suspect we'll get to most of the topics that you want to talk about. We've received also some very good questions that we will be mixing in as well. Each candidate will have 2 minutes to make an opening comments, opening remarks. We will go through a series of questions. We will rotate through the questions. Each candidate will answer every question. So you will hear the same question asked 3 times so you can see how they answer the questions. And also, to be fair, we drew numbers to start, and every question will start with a different person, so each one will ask, will have a chance to answer a question first, second, or third. And we'll continue through that process. The only time we will change that is when we give them the 2 minutes for the summary. We will go in the inverse order of the opening statement. And I've had a sit down with the candidates this evening, and they understand the rules, and I'm expecting this to go extremely well. All questions are timed. Cheryl is the timer. Guys, if you can't see that clock, we'll send you to an optometrist. It will be in 2 minutes. We'll do our best to try to accommodate them, to let them wrap up their thoughts. If they go too far, too long, then I send Rick to the stage and he beats them up and they can't talk anymore. We won't have any problems. It is okay to cheer. It is not okay to jeer. So if something is said that you like and you want to applaud, I would ask, that's certainly okay. I would just ask that you kind of keep it short and sweet. But please refrain from heckling an answer that you may not like. If you do, then you'll have to deal with me. And so we just don't, first of all, I know most of you in here, and so I don't expect that. This is a pretty friendly crowd, except for Carlin. Here we go. Oh, there he is in the back row. I do want to introduce our Sheriff Harlan Moore, who's with us this evening. So thank you, Harlan, for your service. We'll be talking a lot about Harlan after the primaries, because we've got to get this man reelected in November. Without question, Republicans have got to come out and stand strong for Harlan Moore. So without any further ado, I'm going to introduce the candidates in the order in which they drew their numbers. And so if you would allow me to introduce and welcome to the stage, Josh Russell. Joe Wilhelm. And Josh West. Comments, Mr. Russell. Round number one, you get to go first.
Hello, my name is Josh Russell. I'd like to take this time to introduce my family, my wife Rebecca, my daughter Kaylee, and my son Caleb. I grew up in northeastern Oklahoma. I graduated from Grove High School in 1997. After graduating Grove High School, I joined the Marine Corps, where I served 4 years in the United States Marine Corps. I had a secret security clearance and guarded the country's nuclear weapons. I also traveled to 14 different countries, and during that time period, I realized that even though America has its problems, America is still the greatest country in the world. I'm currently partners in my family printing business, which has been in operation for over 30 years. My wife and I served as children's pastors for Grove Christian Center in the last 13 years. And tell you a little bit about my campaign. I've been asked a lot, why am I doing this? Why am I running for office? And why do I want to be a state representative? Well, the answer I give them is, I've sat back and I've seen the morals of our country decline, and I want to be a part of the solution to help fix it. That's one reason I chose the slogan I have on my logo, which is faith, family, freedom. Just faith in God, family, because I believe family is the backbone of every great community, and freedom. I believe that everyone wants freedom, but freedom is something we have to fight for. Now, guys, imagine, the way our country's headed now, 20 years from now, if we don't stand up and fight for the freedom we have, where we're gonna end up. It's not gonna be a pretty place, and it's gonna be, we have to fight for it. Thank you.
Mr. Wilhelm, 2 minutes.
First off, I want to say thank you to NewSong for allowing us to do this. Thank you to Robert. And I also want to take this opportunity to thank both Joshes for your service. I appreciate and acknowledge the veteranship that you've served our country. That is not something I have done. But as a grandson, cousin, and brother of a veteran, I understand the sacrifices you guys have made. And I appreciate that very much, so thank you. A little about myself, I have grown up in Grove my entire life. My parents are educators at Grove Public Schools and have been for the past 35 years. I graduated high school from Grove back in 2007 and decided to pursue a bachelor's degree in music education and music performance at the University of Arkansas. Please don't hold that against me for crossing the lines over the University of Arkansas. Then I quickly found my way back to Grove, where I have served as the assistant band director the last 4 years at Grove, underneath my father as the head band. Public education is the reason I am standing up here today. Absolutely 100%. Now, that being said, I understand the woes the state is suffering between healthcare, the prison systems, DHS, our state troopers, our firemen, our policemen. Because of the lack of fiscal responsibility, all of our public services are suffering right now. I want to look into diversifying this economy. In the state of Oklahoma, I'm tired of riding that roller coaster up and down on oil and gas. solutions are simple, not easy. We have to take the hard routes to fix the simple solutions. Thank you.
Mr. West,
hi, my name is Josh West, and I'm here tonight with my wife, Elizabeth. I just want to give a big shout out to her. She ran a marathon in Joplin last weekend, so she ran 26.2 miles, and so pretty awesome. We've got four children. We've got our oldest is in, well, just got down to third grade, Ethan. Walker just got down to second grade. We've got two daughters, Katie and Aubrey, and three and one. And so we talk about school, and that's going to be a big topic of education. That's the biggest reason that, you know, people say, well, how are we going to know, are you going to support education, Josh? That's the biggest reason I support education, is I know every decision I make is going to affect my children. And so a lot of other reasons. You know, we believe in serving. My wife and I are both veterans. We preach that to our kids. You got to get back to your country, get back to your community. That's another reason we're doing this. You know, it's not easy to put yourself out there. So for Joseph and Josh, you know, I commend you guys too. This has been just an ebbs and flows since last August when we decided to do this. And so, like I say, there's three guys up here trying to make a difference, and we're doing this thing for the right reason, which is to serve. You know, we're going to give back to our communities. I've talked to thousands of people since last August when I started knocking on doors, and that's probably the most rewarding experience. Not every day is good. You know, there's a lot of, like I say, there's a lot of ebbs and flows. If I didn't have my wife to support me and be my biggest fan, I could not do this. And so we spent a lot of time praying before we decided to run for office. We didn't just jump into this decision. A lot of time counseling with our pastor, and you know, the doors opened us, of course, to do this. And we began talking to business people and community leaders. And so when we made this decision, we knew the God was behind it. And we didn't have a choice but to do it. So thank you guys for coming out. And I look forward to hearing from my competitors, and I look forward to talking to you. Thank you.
So, Mr. Russell, you will take the first question. The first question is not going to be specific to any one issue you meet gentlemen tonight. My first question is, what do you consider to be the three most important issues facing Delaware County? Mr. Russell?
The three most important issues I find out is education, economy, and family structure. And I believe, in a way, all those are kind of tied together, because without an educated workforce, I mean, we're all here because we care about education, because it's a real hot topic in Oklahoma. It's underfunded, it's got its issues besides funding, but that's an issue. I believe education also affects the economy. Because without an educated workforce, our entrepreneurs and people that are corporations can't find the workforce to be able to work for their companies. And a family is important because, I believe that is the thing that holds everything together. And like in Delaware County, for instance, since you mentioned Delaware County has one of the highest divorce rates in Oklahoma, and I believe that has to do with a weak economy, education. So I think those are the three main concerns.
Thank you. Mr. Wilcom, second question. What are the three most important issues facing Delaware County?
The number one most important issue in Northeast Oklahoma and Delaware County is healthcare. Our population is the oldest population North in the state of Oklahoma. We're the largest and oldest population in Northeast Oklahoma. That is the number one problem we're facing with right now in terms of budget crisis, is healthcare. We have to make sure we're providing for our senior citizens. We have to make sure that they're taken care of. Number two, why am I here? Education. Education, public education. Every student deserves and has the right to get a good quality education. Rowe High School's diploma should be the same as Owosso, should be the same as Norman North, should be the same as Guyana. Education has got to be a higher priority for Northeast Oklahoma and for the state. And the third thing is tourism. Tourism also ties into our economy. In Northeast Oklahoma, we've got to continue to focus on bringing in people to Northeast Oklahoma. This is the best kept secret in all of the Midwest, is Grand Lake. We've got to continue to thrive bringing in different types of people to continue to boost our economy and to bring in more money that we can provide for our children, provide for our senior citizens. Those are the three most important things in Northeast Oklahoma has got to remember in Oklahoma City. Thank you.
Three most important issues facing Delaware County?
Three most important issues facing Delaware County, I would say one is education. Like I said, I'm a parent of four young children, and I would, you know, if I were going to pay higher taxes for something, it would be for my children's education. And it's easy to sit back and look at everything that comes out and play armchair quarterback. Like I said, we're underfunded, but I want to find out why. You know, we've got 51% of our budget goes to education, so I want to know why we can't fund education. This is not like we've just arrived here. We've never been outside of the bottom 10% education in the history of Oklahoma. And so we need to stop blaming parties. This is not a Democratic party. This is not a Democratic problem. This is not a Republican problem. This is a state problem. And so let's just fix it. Let's get some guys in there. They're going to do the right thing and fix it. Every teacher I know went to Oklahoma City when I was a kid. I started first grade here in 1982, 1983. And they went to Oklahoma City every year, and they picketed for, advocated for higher pay, and the same things they do now. And back then, we blamed the Democrats. So let's stop blaming a party that's just fixed the problem. Yes, we're underfunded. A big reason that we are underfunded, last year, we put an additional $200 million in education. We didn't see it. Our insurance ate it up, the teacher's insurance ate it up. Another problem is our important issue is the local economy. From a growth standpoint, tourism has always been the lead in this area. Yes, it's very important, but also we need jobs outside of tourism. You know, we need the Daryl Robertsons to come in and take chances on these small communities and start businesses. He's opened up a new tank plant in Oklahoma that's going to bring another 100 jobs to that part of the country. And so that can change a town. And then third, I would say our infrastructure. Roads and bridges are in terrible shape. I drive about 200 miles a day on these roads. And so I would say I'm running out of time. So that's my final one. Infrastructure being number three.
Well, y'all are all in luck because we have a lot of questions about education, the economy, and healthcare, and infrastructure, and tourism. So, good job with your issues. At least we are ready for you. So the second question will go first to Joe Wilman. And it is an education question. Education is top of mind for the state right now. I think we would all agree with that. It's been made more complex by the budget shortfalls that we are experiencing. Are you in support of the proposed Boren bill that will add 1% sales tax to each and every community?
Thank you, Robert. This is a very, very hot topic right now. Obviously, as a Republican, the last thing we want to do is raise taxes. We don't want to do that. Fortunately enough, it's not a vote of the people, and we'll find out in November what the state of Oklahoma wants to do. Personally, this has been a struggle for me. As an educator, I want to see what's best for the state of Oklahoma's public education system. The only thing the penny sales tax is looking at doing, from what I understand, is raising the teacher pay. Now, I would love to sit up here and tell you, as a teacher, I want more money. But that's not why I'm up here. I want what's best for Northeast Oklahoma. Right now, we're sitting at a 9.3 sales tax. We take that penny sales and go up above 10.3, we're going to be losing money to Joplin, Missouri. You can easily drive 45 minutes by a washer and dryer cheaper if this tax goes through than you can right here in Grove, Oklahoma. Unfortunately, it's like that across the state. Numerous towns have high sales tax already. Janita's at 9.8, Jay's at 9.5. there are cities and towns that will suffer if this proposed sales tax goes through. But I think, and I'm excited for it, to see what's going to happen in November, to see what the people of Oklahoma would like to do. Like Josh said, do they want to raise taxes for education? Or do they value their own personal sales tax? So it'll be interesting to see, and I'm excited to see what you have to say in November. Thank you.
Same question. Are you in support of the proposed?
I feel like I'm repeating people's tonight. But yeah, like Joseph was saying, people are going to drive out of state. That's the bottom line. People are going to drive out of state. And I want to know, is Boyer going to lower his tuition if this passes? Probably not. He's going to raise tuition. So, like I said, these border towns, people are going to go other places. The towns closer to the south, they're going to go to Dallas to get stuff. And so, if it was truly going to help, and if it's hard to, like I say, I can't sit back here and with the information I'm being shown, and everything you see on the internet is extreme. You see the far left, you see the far right. And so, me personally, no, I couldn't support it.
No, I would not support the sales tax for the same reasons. I think there's other ways we can put money in the classroom besides raising taxes. I think if we raise taxes anymore, especially that will put Oklahoma at one of the highest sales tax rates in the nation. And like these other Josh and Joseph have said, we live in the northeast corner part of the state. And so that does make it hard for our economy to be able to compete with these other states. So I believe we need to keep where it is, keep the money in the state of Oklahoma, and figure out other ways to put money into the classrooms.
Thank you. This next question will go first to Mr. West, and it is, in a sense, a follow-up to this question, since you all three are on the same page with being not in favor of the 1%, what are your thoughts on how to advance teacher salaries without incurring taxes? Mr. West, first question for you.
Well, like I said earlier, when over 50% of the budget goes to education, I want to find out why we can't fund it. I look at, I spent years in the military, and I was a non-commissioned officer, and I look at our teachers as the backbone of our education system. As a non-commissioned officer, I was the backbone of our teacher, the trainer, the mentor. That's what I look at our teachers as. They're the teachers, the trainers, the mentor of our children. And so we need to make it more about our teachers and our children. When we make these decisions, we need to keep those two things in the forefront. If you look at the 51% of the budget that goes to education, over half of that goes to non-teaching jobs. And so we've got people out here in Tulsa. I was watching an article on TV the other day, or watching a news story, and they're cutting, it was 60 admin jobs and 140 teaching positions. Well, I've got a problem with that. You know, I think our priorities are messed up. So it's hard to sit here and give you the exact answer on it because we don't know until you get up in there. You know, I was told early on, they said, you're going to know exactly what every new legislator knows, Josh, if you get elected, which is absolutely nothing. And so you got to get up in there and you got to learn. You got to find out the real truth instead of what we see on Facebook or the internet. So, thank you.
What are your thoughts on how to advance teachers' salaries without incurring additional taxes?
You know, one of the things we can do is we need to find additional sources of revenue to subsidize the oil industry, but also we need to, like Josh has said, is find out where the money is going. It's hard to sit there up here and say, you know, this is the solution, this is going to fix it, but until you find out where all the money is being spent. And I do agree there is it doesn't seem like the teachers are getting the money that they should be, but it seems like the administrators are way up here, so I don't know if there's a way to maybe consolidate some of that administration to cut some of the costs off of that. Because we gotta look at it and save up home at that, the teachers is the backbone of the workforce that's going to drive and do the and improve the education for the state of Oklahoma. So we need to do anything we can to put as much dollars in the classroom as we can.
Thank you. Mr. Lemon, same question, how do we advance teacher salaries without incurring additional taxes?
Well, Mr. West alluded to, we put over 50% of our budget into education. 50% of what? Right now, in the last 2 years, we've incurred a $1.3 billion, that's billion dollars, shortfall in our tax revenue. This next fiscal year, 1 year, it will be $1 billion. So in a matter of 3 years, the state of Oklahoma has figured out how to lose over $2 billion in 3 years. So yes, we do put a large amount of percentage of our budget into education, but it's not a very large budget to start with. We have to look at ways to diversify and bring in and supplement our tax revenue. One prime example is Pryor, Oklahoma. In Pryor, Oklahoma, I don't know if you're aware of this, there's a Google substation, an information hub in Pryor, Oklahoma. Being a band director, I get to chat with numerous band directors across the state, and we were sharing our woes. We had a third band director lose his job this year. And they're really? We're getting a raise this year with our third band director. Why? Because the property values have gone up, and the ad valorem tax has gone up in Pryor, Oklahoma because of that information. You go 3 hours south of Oklahoma City to Dallas, marketing firms, tech agencies, information hubs. We have got to look at that type of 21st century jobs instead of, again, riding that roller coaster of the energy industry. We can't keep going up and down and up and down. We have to learn. If I'm not able to pay all my bills from my teacher income, what do? I find a second job to supplement my income. That's what the state of Oklahoma has got to figure out how to do.
I'm going to stay with education for a second with a few more questions, and this was touched on by one of you, but it is a pretty controversial topic. What is your position, and by the way, you will go first with this question, Joe.
I believe it is.
You asked first this last time? Yeah, was it you? Good job. Me, not so much. What is your position on the consolidation of school superintendents and the potential reduction of non-teaching positions?
I think it's something that needs to be looked at, especially in this area where it is an issue of having. From what I was told, we spent $500,000 on an administration building that's full of administrators. Hope there's no administrators in Scott or something, I mean. But anyway, so it is an issue, and it does need to be addressed. It does need to be talked about. Can it be applied to every district statewide? Probably not. But in areas like ours, we can probably look at the district and find out how many superintendents you can take to consolidate certain districts and improve, you know, in a manageable range. Because I know it is a superintendent does have a hard job, but they do have to be able to manage, you know, their staff effectively. But yes, I do believe it is something that needs to be addressed, needs to be looked at.
Okay. Same question.
Could you repeat the question again? I want to give specifics.
I can. What is your position on consolidation of school superintendents and potential reduction of non-teaching?
Right now, if you were to fire all the superintendents across the state, every superintendent in Oklahoma, I think Oklahoma would save roughly $40 million. That might be a penny in the bucket. And there's no way we're firing all superintendents across the state. If we cut 50%, we look at saving maybe $20 million. And there's no way we cut half of the superintendents across the state. What we've got to look at doing is the specifics of where the money is going. Right now, the public schools are so mandated, we have this A to F report card. It takes data on data on data to actually figure out if you scored an A, B, C, D, or F. That takes administrators and paying jobs. That is where we should look at starting to trend some of the funding. Not the actual leader itself, but this absurd data that we have to collect, that our principals have to collect, that we hire people under the principals to collect for each classroom, for each roster verification. That's where a lot of the waste money is going right now because of the mandates.
I'll agree with both of them. Well, let me tell you what, there's 511 school districts in the state, and every single school district has a superintendent. Out of those 511 school districts, there's 140 with 150 kids or less, and there's 80 with 100 kids or less. And so there's a superintendent in every school district, whether there's 40 kids in a school district or 4,000. So that's something I got to look at. I was talking to a guy in Oklahoma City the other day, and we were looking at that, and really, all but about 7 counties in the state, you could go to a countywide superintendent. And like Joseph is saying, I don't know if it's possible. We are over mandated to the point where the teachers can't hardly teach anymore. Now they did it today, it was voted that they are doing what they ought. And so that's a good thing right there. Because after they come back from spring break, normally they're done. I mean, their teachers were teaching and testing, couldn't blame them because their job depended on it. So it's a good thing that the UIs are being done away with. I don't think you can mandate teachers on the top. We've got to get on a local level. And so we got to get parents a bigger say. We've got to get teachers a bigger say on what's taught. We've got to get local school boards a bigger say on what's taught. And in that case, your parents are going to step up and raise their kids. You can't expect a school board.
There you go.
But, you know, who knows if it's possible? You know, you don't know until you get in there and you see the correct information.
Okay. The next question. Go to Mr. Goldman. Gotta get this right, I only get one mistake. We're still in education. This is a pretty hot topic today. Where are you and what are your thoughts concerning the federal mandate on states on ruling as it relates to transgender bathrooms? Oh, I don't remember to ask that question. You don't get to pass the question. You have to answer the question.
You said, do you get to pass?
I
saw some information yesterday. 19% of American citizens are disabled. 0.3% of American citizens are transgender. You tell me which one we should be focusing on. Why should we be in this debate right now? The fact that I'm sitting up here talking about this, and instead of talking about what can we do to better educate our children. This, to me, the government should not be involved in. This is one of the reasons. There's no reason we should be talking about this right now. Absolutely. And it frustrates me as a Republican to see the Republicans getting involved in this. It should not be a topic. Thank you.
I agree with Joseph. This is not a federal issue. The federal government has no right to tell states how to run their schools, how to run their bathrooms. So no one else support it. Like you said, this is a waste of time. There's a lot better things we could be doing than talking about transgender bathrooms. Let's get on and focus on the real stuff, you know. There's about 4 days left, there's 4 days left to get a budget together. So, you know, we're going to wait till the 11th hour to get a budget together. It's going to be thrown together. It's going to be a mess. So let's focus on the real thing.
Well, I agree with both of them. Transgender bathrooms should not be a mandate. It should not even be an issue. And honestly, growing up, I never thought, that we would even be having this problem or this issue. And I don't know if your stats are right, 0.3%. But 0.3% is correct. Why are we even addressing it? There is a lot of other problems that we could be talking about. and education is definitely one of them, healthcare, prisons. But yes, I don't believe transgender bathrooms should be on that list.
For the record, neither do I. We're going to ask the question.
Thank you.
Regarding school vouchers, and this question goes first to Mr. West, do you support a plan for vouchers or a voucher program?
I support parental choice. I don't care if you send your kids to a private school. I don't care if you homeschool your kids. I don't care if you send your kids to a public school. And I support true parental choice. I think you should be able to send your kids to any school you want. You know, it's a hassle. If you want to go send your kids to school, Jay, send them to Jay. But there's no private schools in Grand Oklahoma or anywhere else in this district. And so I have never supported the voucher system. I quoted in the paper from last August saying, you know, I support parental choice, but I don't support vouchers. I've got phone calls from the last 2 weeks from our teachers and administrators saying, did you change your mind? You know? So there's some wrong information going on. So I've never supported vouchers. Just for the fact that you're going to be taking money away from our small rural schools. It's kind of became a rural versus urban battle. You know, the urban areas, they want these vouchers, but you know, I can't support something that's going to take away money from our small rural schools. I kind of look at it as, you know, I don't like my sheriff's department, and so I want you to give me my money. I'm paying taxes, and I'm going to start my own sheriff's department. That's kind of how I look at it. So,
okay.
I do support vouchers, and the reason I do support vouchers is coming from a business standpoint. I believe Oklahoma needs to look at other options. Obviously, you know, like we've mentioned, Oklahoma has ranked last and or the bottom 10 in education for quite some time. This is something that we can, you know, in business it's called competition. So I believe if we open up competition in the education industry, it'll open up other ways and avenues of approaching education that hasn't been thought of. We can't expect to be doing the same thing year in, year out, and expect different results. We got to do something different, and if this is it, if it does pass, hopefully it works, and hopefully it improves education. But I do agree that homeschooling and other options are another way to improve education, and this will also give more parents a way to put their kids in private schools, homeschool, and kind of help with that that expense.
I can quickly come up and say I am passionately against vouchers. Why? We would lose over $900,000 a year towards public education. What vouchers would do? We continue to drive a wedge in between the lower and higher income quality type students. Now, that being said, I have zero problem with parents choosing what their students should attend, whether it be a private school, whether it be a public school, whether it be homeschool. But I don't want my public money going to those private schools, going to those charter schools. Now, no, Northeast Oklahoma does not have a private school. We do have charter schools. And the public school has lost, I believe, over 100 kids to this charter school. We're losing Grow Public Schools. I'm sure Jay, I'm sure Cleora, Salina, is losing money because of that choice. Because students are leaving, the attendance goes down in the schools, the funding goes down. The funding goes up in these charter schools which don't even have a building. They don't have a bathroom to teach about transgender. They don't have brick and mortar. Public money should go to public schools, not anything else. Thank you.
Last question on education. I believe Mr. Russell, you're first this time. And that is, and I think we're going to know the answer to this question, I'm going to ask it anyway. What is your opinion on school choice? Do you support school choice?
Yes, I believe. I support school choice 100%. I believe the parent knows the best way to educate their children. For instance, we homeschooled our son in first grade because he was, you know, serving some errors with speech and his eyesight. He had to have eye surgery. And so at that time, It was the best choice for him. He's now attending public Grove schools, and it gave him kind of a leg up and a way to be able to get where he needed to be, and gave us that option to be able to do so. So yes, I believe support school choice 100%.
Again, I believe I touched on it, the previous statement. No problem, absolutely no problem. With parents, what do parents do when they move? First thing they look at, the school system. That's their choice. That's the parents' right, the citizens' right to choose whether they put their kids in private school, home school, or public education. Again, public money should go to public education. Another thing I would like to touch on right now is homeschool. No problem with homeschooling whatsoever. Again, parent choice, absolutely, it's common sense. What the state needs to look at is some accountability for these homeschools. Sometimes we have children who homeschool, and rightfully so, they have needs where they need to do that, and the parent feels comfortable teaching them at home. But sometimes they come back into the public education system and they're lost. The teacher has no idea how to reach that student because they don't know what level they're reading at, what level their math is at, or anything like that. The state has got to do a better job of keeping homeschoolers accountable.
I know y'all are disappointed, but I've run out of education questions.
Yes, I support parental choice. Every single case. That's my answer. I support it. We don't want to be dead horse here. Yeah. Hey, you know your kids best. So, wherever you want to send your kids to school, it's your right as a parent.
Let's move on to some health care questions. Last week, the legislature voted overwhelmingly to dramatically reduce and or eliminate abortion in our state. As you know, the governor has vetoed the bill. How would you have voted had you been in Congress in order to cast a vote? And what would you do as far as the vote to override the veto? And let's see, I believe it's wrong.
Let me first off by saying I'm 100% pro-life. Now, what I want to talk about is how we got to that subject of abortion in the state legislature. It was a pure political move. From what I've read and gathered, they did this simply because they wanted to challenge the federal government. Now, there are times where that is necessary. But when you have, again, a 1.3 budget deficit on top of next year's $1 billion budget deficit, that's not something we should be doing right now. That's not something we should be voting for just because we want a lawsuit with the federal government. That's taxpayers' money that we're losing because of simple political games. That is not something the state, and thankfully the governor did something right by vetoing that, because she knew that's all it was going to do. That's all this was for, is for a lawsuit. So while I am 100% pro-life, it needs to be done the right way.
So just to clarify, so you would have voted no?
Because of how we got to that point, yes, okay. I would have voted no.
And then in the case of this, you would vote no for the override?
Sure.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Just want to make sure you clarify that. All right?
I would have voted yes. I'm so pro-life as well. Abortion has always been legal in the state, though. However, the government did it unconstitutional, so that's what makes abortion in the state. Like Joseph was saying, though, I think that we would have been in a lawsuit forever. I would have still voted for it, but I think that this would have gone to a federal judge, and they would have been unconstitutional, so we would have wasted a lot of money on it. And so, I've got four kids, and I've heard all their heartbeats. You know, within 6 weeks of my wife being pregnant, so I'm going to always take the side of pro-life. But I think that, like I say, we've got to talk about it. I don't know the way to properly do it, but.
When the veto bill comes forth, would you support the veto? Would you vote the veto?
I would
to
support
override the veto, or would you vote to go with the government?
I would support the right. I would support the veto. I'm just saying, I have worries that it's going to be a waste of money. But like I said, I hadn't talked to my pastor about this. I said, what do you, as a pastor? Because, you know, I'm not a doctor, and I have a wife. I've got two daughters, and so I was talking to my pastor about it, and you know, I don't know if my wife was pregnant and the doctor said your wife is going to die, if she had this baby. And, you know, it's a hard decision to make. You know, I've got two daughters, so it could happen someday. So it's a touchy situation, but, you know, I'll take the side of pro-life every time.
Let Mr. Russell answer the question. And then if you have a comment, we'll give you a minute to respond.
I'm 100% pro-life, and I would I support the bill to override abortion and end abortion in Oklahoma. I believe that as a state, we have the right to make our own laws. And I believe if Oklahoma citizens want to be pro-life and end abortion in Oklahoma, we have the right to do so. And whether I don't believe the federal government has a right to come in and tell us as a state what we can and cannot do. And I believe, you know, if it came to a lawsuit, I think we should have fought it and stand our ground, just like, you know, what I said earlier about freedom. If we want to have freedom, we got to fight for it. And it's not something we need to roll over every time, you know, we're afraid to do something. I believe if Oklahoma would have taken an initial stance to end pro-life or to end abortion in Oklahoma, I believe other states would have followed suit because we would have taken a lead on it. Thank you.
I would just like to ask for some clarification. I was having a hard time understanding. I just want to make sure I heard right that you said you would vote yes, Mr. West, even if you knew it would cost taxpayers money.
I said I would vote yes. I would be worried. I need to see true numbers, but it would worry me that this was going to be tied up in federal court. But, you know, there's something to be said about having a moral compass. I think voters want a representative with a moral compass, and there's some things that I'm not going to sway on. That's one of them.
So you even with this
yes.
budget shortfall, you would,
yes.
you would tag on that?
We don't know.
Last time I checked, I'm the moderator, so appreciate the question and the answer, but we're going to move on. I believe the question was answered by all three. I will say for the record, any money to fight the bill was already funded. It would not have cost the state of Oklahoma one penny.
Yay, thank you.
I encourage you to look at the legislation. The state is currently, let's see who gets the first question this time. I believe it is Mr. West. The state is currently considering several options as they pertain to Medicare and Medicaid and in working with Obamacare in general. What are your thoughts on managing our spiraling healthcare costs? And how much leverage do you feel the state has in dealing with the federal health care mandate?
Well, this is a hot topic in my house. My wife's a therapist, and so, you know, probably 75% or better of her payments come from some type of federal funding. And so I understand why that we voted not to expand Medicare. I mean, we're going to make an agreement with the federal government for hundreds of millions of dollars. I'm sorry, Medicaid, for hundreds of millions of dollars to develop a healthcare plan for hundreds of thousands of Oklahomans. And so, you know, what happens when, yes, the federal government was going to pay 100% for up to 4 years, I think. Well, after that, we're stuck with a bill of 10 to 20%. And so that's why they voted not to do it. And at the time, the constituents were saying, no, you do not want, they looked at it as Obamacare. And so when they voted to do that, they were being, that's what the constituents wanted. And so there was no way to tell at the time that, you know, this is a budget thing. There's no way to tell at the time that oil and gas is going to take such a big drop. I mean, oil and gas revenues make up 25% of our economy, and that takes a 70% decline in less than a year. We're going to have problems. I'm for helping people who need help, but there's a lot of fraud and waste and abuse in that system, as with any government system. And so, you know, the vote was up last week for a sin tax at $1.50 to cigarettes, and so that would have helped education, that would have helped the Medicare, that would have helped our people that are losing their insurance. And so, you know, I probably would have supported that for the sin tax. You know, people, Arkansas is a sin tax, and people leave Arkansas to go there to teach at their schools were partially funded by the sin tax. So, you know, that's I would have supported that decision right there.
Okay.
question.
Healthcare is a huge topic for this, for not only the state of Oklahoma, but for the nation. My problem with any government program is I believe we become too dependent on it. I believe Obamacare has literally destroyed the healthcare industry. I don't like federal mandates. I don't like mandates placed on states that if you do this, we'll give you this. So I would not have supported any mandates to receive more money for Medicaid.
This, like has been stated, is a very hot topic right now. After speaking with lots of physicians across Delaware County, whether they are on the right or left side, they see what's happening with our senior citizens. They see that there are people losing money they had no idea was going to lose money because we turned away help. Now, I understand what comes along with that help. It's unfortunate that that happens, but this state is in too much of a budget crisis to say no to help. We have got to make sure we take care of our senior citizens. When I educate the children in rural public schools, I look at them and they're going to be making decisions while I'm a senior citizen and I can't help for myself. I want to make sure that they're going to take care of me, which is what our legislation should be doing right now at Oklahoma City to make sure we're taking care of our senior citizens.
How would you suggest that if we pay this back when the bill comes up? We take all this federal monies. How are we going to, we have to foot the bill as a state, how do we pay it back?
Well, like you said, the sin tax. I would totally agree with the sin tax. What that's going to do is that's going to raise the tax on cigarettes, which is going to hopefully decrease. That way we generate some more tax revenue for our health care.
Okay, thank you. I'm going to move on to some, what I'm calling some of the pending legislative activities that are going on in the state. Interested in your thoughts and how you, if you were there, how you would vote on some of these issues. The next question concerns the Second Amendment, what they're calling an open carry legislation. There's pending legislation that would allow any adult over the age of 21 without a felony conviction to openly carry loaded handguns without a license, background check, or training. Oklahoma residents currently can carry guns openly or concealed. It must be penalized, that includes a fingerprint check and firearms training. What are your thoughts on this measure, and do you know how you would vote if given the opportunity to ask you to be here?
Okay. I'm a strong supporter of the Second Amendment, and I would support a open carry bill if they don't have a felony. But the thing is it's kind of hard because got to prove they don't have a felony. I mean, if they're carrying it. So I have talked to several gun stores and people that do sell firearms and are pro Second Amendment, and there's really no way around it. But if you go by the Constitution, and that's one thing that I've always said, if elected, that you judge everything by is the Constitution, whether it's legal, whether it's law, and you judge that by that. So I would support a, based on those documents, I would support a open carry bill.
Can you repeat the middle part of that question?
Yeah, what are your thoughts on the measure, and how would you vote on the opportunity, given the opportunity for the open carry law for those over 21 to carry without background?
Without a background check?
Without background checks or training.
Without proper certification. While I fully support the Second Amendment and it is every single citizen's right to carry, we have to do it smart. We have to do it intelligent. There's no way I want to be walking around Walmart thinking there might be somebody open carrying that has no training or certification on it. No way. Just like I don't want a doctor working on me that has no certification, has no business being a doctor. If there's someone that has a gun and no business having a gun, To me, that's common sense. You should have with something that has such a traumatic effect, like a gun, you should have some type of certification and background checks.
Well, we already have open carry on the books now. You know you can open carry if you've been through a concealed class. So, I'm as biggest Second Amendment supporter as there is anyway. I've told you I served in the military. I shot 3 times in Iraq, and so I'm not talking about the Constitution. I support it. I defended the Constitution. And so the Second Amendment is an inherent right. Man cannot give the right to or take it away. But I talked to Sarah. I went around talking to business people. These are conservative-minded business people. And I was talking about the bill that was in the vote. And I asked them, I said, what do you think? You know, I mean, we're talking about rural Oklahoma here. So this is a rural area. People grew up hunting and fishing. And I think we need to use some common sense to that. Like I said, this is nothing about not supporting the Second Amendment. I support the Second Amendment. But I think that you have to go through some training. I can go to a gun shop and take every weapon there. I can take it apart, put together, get a function ship, and qualify on that weapon. But some people can't. Especially in here in Grove, Oklahoma, yeah, they probably could. A lot of people could, but again, in these urban areas. And so I think that we need to use common sense on it, and I would need to actually see the bill. The bill changed several times. And it got pushed out because of the business people. And I think if it did pass, then I think as a business owner, you have the right to determine who comes in your business. And so it's not anything about being against the Second Amendment. There was a rumor going around. People were saying I was against the Second Amendment because of this right here. And so I fully support the Second Amendment. This is an Oklahoma law, so we need to use common sense.
In a separate measure supported by the NRA, they're seeking a statewide public vote on amending the Oklahoma Constitution to make it harder for the legislature to regulate firearms and prohibit laws requiring registration or special taxation of firearms or ammunition. Do you support the NRA position that has also been taken, or do you support the position that has been taken by many of the hospitals, colleges, many businesses, including the Oklahoma City Thunder? Mr. Wilmot.
Again, like I stated earlier, I'm a strong proponent of the Second Amendment, but with intelligence. We have to make sure we don't have somebody with a lethal weapon that has no training, certification, or background checks. We've got to make sure the people that are holding this equipment knows what they're doing with it. Now the question is, do I support the NRA's...
they have a motion to ask the state to modify their constitution to make it harder.
So they're trying to make it harder on...
For the legislature to actually enact legislation.
Sure. That is... That's a tricky subject. I don't believe that businesses should be running government. I think the legislators should be running the government.
Okay. I need more information on the topic. I mean, what's the question?
Since in a separate measure supported by the National Rifle Association, they're seeking a statewide public vote on amending the Oklahoma Constitution to make it harder for the legislature to regulate firearms and prohibit laws requiring registration or special taxation of firearms or ammunition. Do you support the NRA position or the position that has been taken by most of the hospitals, colleges, and many businesses, including the Oklahoma City Thunder?
You can't legislate the Constitution, you have to change it. Make changes that you can't legislate. But then again, like I was saying, I think this gives we've got to use common sense because let somebody go out and kill a large group of people with this open carry topic we're talking about. I think that gives an avenue for the government to come take your weapons. You're going to cause such an outpour, and people are going to say, well, it's because Oklahoma, a bunch of rednecks down there, they're walking around open carry, and look what happened. No training whatsoever. And so, as far as the NRA standpoint, I need more information on it. I don't want to make an incorrect answer, so I need more information.
I also support the Second Amendment. So. And I also, I love the NRA, I love what they do, support gun rights, but I'm not, I don't support just changing the Constitution just because, to fit their needs. Because I believe if we start doing that, we open up a whole kind of precedent, so to speak, that anybody can come and start changing the Constitution just to fit their needs or whatever they want to do. So, no, I don't think we should change the Second Amendment for the NRA.
Josh West, question to you. Last week, the GRDA announced that they had failed to reach an agreement with REC concerning power provided by GRDA. The impact of this could result in an increase of our local utility costs. What are your thoughts on the failure of this agreement? And do you think that the state legislature should step in to help control utility costs?
You know, GRDA is a great asset to this area. I've seen talking points from one side. I've seen the GRDA side. I've seen Ed Townsend, what he wrote. And so, but I need to see both sides. And I don't think REC's put out anything on why they didn't take the deal. And so, but I don't think legislation needs to be involved. We're talking about a private company. With a state entity, I mean, I need to see both sides. I don't think you can make a comment about seeing what REC does. I haven't put out anything yet. So that's where I stand with that.
Mr. Russell.
GRDA is a huge asset to this community. I think without legislative being involved, we need to get them to work out an agreement as much as possible. I think last case scenario is legislation having getting involved in.
It's unfortunate that GRDA and REC split ways after 70 years of working well together. At the same time, I'm a Republican because I appreciate small government. So no, absolutely not should the government get in the way of what has gone well for GRDA and REC. I believe it should be between those two corporations to make sure that it gets taken care of. Now, could there be a type of county judge moderating? Possible, but I don't think the state level should be getting involved with what's going on up here in Northeast Oklahoma in terms of GRDA and REC.
Mr. Russell, the next question will come to you. You had that look of anticipation. Many current budget issues are being corrected now by dipping into the state's rainy day fund. What are your thoughts about continuing to withdraw from this fund, and how can these funds be replenished?
Well, if we continue to dip into the rainy day funds, and if we continue to function on a deficit, eventually we'll go bankrupt. So if we don't want to do that, we need to figure out how to live within the budget and make it work. We need to make cuts where they need to make cuts. Oil industry and natural resources, unfortunately, are a huge resource to our state as far as funding wise. Good thing is oil is starting to go back up. So hopefully we can see an increase in funds to help help cover the budget deficit.
Could you repeat the question for me?
Many of the current budget issues seem to be reduced by dipping into the rainy day fund. What are your thoughts about continuing to withdraw these funds, and how can the funds be replenished?
Well, we have the rainy day fund for rainy days. Right now, I think we're in a thunderstorm. Between 2008 and 2014, the oil industry was booming. Fantastic. North Dakota and Texas had a 32% upswing in their tax revenue. What did Oklahoma do? We lost 28%. Why? Because the taxes stayed low. It stayed between 1 and 2%, while North Dakota and Texas raised from 7 to 11.5% because they knew what was going to come. That is where we made the mistake, between 2008 and 2014, of supplementing that rainy day fund. I believe we have something like $300 million in rainy day fund. North Dakota has over $1 billion in the rainy day fund. Now, like I said earlier, we should use it when we have a rainy day. And right now, the education, I think the governor allowed a $50 million reach into that rainy day fund, a one-time thing. Now, I think that was a smart decision to make it a one-time thing. This shouldn't be something where we use it every now and then. We are truly in a crisis right now. I hope Oklahoma understands we are in a crisis in the budget terms. Our middle schoolers were walking around in the dark in the hallways because we couldn't afford to pay the lights. We got out 11 days early because we couldn't afford to pay our bills. We lost 12 teachers in Grove because we couldn't afford to pay the bills. So yes, we should have tapped and did tap into the rainy day fund, but the state has got to do a much more responsible job at creating more revenue into that tax revenue, into that rainy day fund, just like North Dakota and Texas did. When the oil goes up, like Mr. Russell alluded to, like it's going to now, we've got to be smarter about it. We've got to make sure we raise our taxes, because where do you get oil from? Oklahoma, North Dakota, and Texas. People are not going to leave Oklahoma if you raise it just a hair. They're not going to.
Question, you know?
Many of the current budget issues seem to be reduced by dipping into the rainy day fund. What are your thoughts about continuing to withdraw these funds, and how can these funds be replenished?
Well, I support the decision to take the money out that we did. As a state government, we don't have the luxury of going trillions of dollars in debt like the federal government does. And so, you know, there's not a legislator up there that wants to make any cuts, I promise you that. We're constitution mandated to balance the budget. And so I think until we make agencies, we need to go a line by line budget. You know, at home I can't just spend what I want, I have to go line by line. And so until we make agencies actually show on paper where the money's going, we're gonna keep having these problems. We're gonna have these problems. It's the same thing that happened in the early 80s, late 70s with the oil industry. Like I said, it makes up 25% of our economy. We're gonna have this problem. It takes a 7% decline. And so we gotta continue diversifying our economy. We've done better with the fiber optics arena. We've done better with the aerospace industries. But if we want to see a better economy in Oklahoma, we gotta diversify. You know, I work in agriculture, but there are no, we're talking about cattle, we're talking about crops. Commodities statewide aren't doing well. So we gotta look for different ways to add up to our economy and grow the economy. I'm not saying we should take away all tax incentives. We just need to be smart about it. And if we're gonna offer tax incentives, then it needs to give us economic growth. Thank you.
Following up on this, I want to ask the next question. Is would you continue tax breaks that could have a negative impact on the state budget? We talked about the rainy day fund. We've got a couple different solutions here. Try to fix that one, raising taxes, another one's cutting some spending. But we haven't addressed the tax breaks specifically. Would you continue tax breaks that could have a negative impact on our state budget? I believe that question goes to Mr. Buck.
Like I mentioned earlier tonight, Pryor has something phenomenal in the Google Information Hub. They had their tax breaks, they had their allowance, and they said, okay, we don't need it anymore. We're gonna start giving back to the community. That's exactly what has to happen to the entire state. That's what has to happen to the oil and energy. They're not so big that we can't raise their taxes and get rid of their tax cuts. They're going to be phenomenal for the state if they let us be responsible fiscally. Like I mentioned earlier, there are other states doing it just fine. Raising it above 2% tax rate is not going to kill this oil industry when it's on the uptick like it is right now.
I think we can learn from our mistakes, Robert. If it's gonna, you know, there's guys that forecast this stuff out for years. We can't keep doing the same thing over and get the same results. So, you know, like I say, learn from our mistakes, and you've got to put a cap. Like I say, the oil industry is very important to us, but we got to be smart. You got to put a cap on. You know, you don't have to take the oil out of the brakes, but like Joseph was saying, you got to look at what's important to state. And right now, that extra money would help us. And I'm not anti-business. We need business, especially around here. We're looking to grow. Tourism is very important, but we need stuff outside of tourism, like I said. You know, I talked to the guys down Prior here last summer. I was talking at a meeting about Prior. They're fully funded. They don't receive a penny of, like Joseph was saying, any state monies. Their school received $460 million last year because of the Mid-American Industrial Park. And we don't have that. We don't have a railroad, which that hurts us here. But we have an awesome airport now. And so we need to showcase this area. We need to bring in these potential employers. Not only that, but the employers are here. We need them to operate without the government for everything they do.
The question is that addressing like tax incentives and tax credits and stuff like that.
If you continue any tax breaks, that could have an impact on the state level.
All right. Well, being a business owner, I don't think it's fair practice to have the government interfere. I was talking to this one guy. He said, it's like you have a Burger King in one corner and another hamburger joint right next to the street, across the street. And you have, this is the Burger King that had his property and everything paid for, but given to him by the local government or whatever. So how is that fair to the hamburger joint across the street that's trying to, you know, make a living and build a business and do everything the right way on a fair market enterprise? So, no, I think government needs to stay out of it. And I asked this guy, I said, if that's not it, I said, how would you address, bringing businesses in? Because a lot of politicians and business leaders say we need taxes and incentives. But the thing is he told me, and I agree with him, he said, if they're not in your area, he said, if they're not there, they're moving there, there's a reason for it. It's because it's not profitable and they shouldn't be there in the first place. So I got 48 seconds. So they said, I think the government did the same thing to the wind energy. They gave all these people taxes and incentives to build windmills and stuff like that. And if you study wind energy is actually the least effective and the most expensive energy to produce. So after this is all out and that market crashes, what you're gonna have is a bunch of windmills all over the state. So I think the government needs to stay out of business, and we just need to do the jobs that we know we need to do.
In our time that we have left, we want to move to infrastructure questions. And I do want to talk about some tourism issues here. If you've driven down any of the roads in Oklahoma, you know that the infrastructure is a little bit out of date. When you drive under bridges, you duck because you're afraid they're going to fall down on your head. If you had been in Oklahoma City this week, it could have happened to you. How should the legislature approach the improvements of the Oklahoma's roads and bridges in lieu of the certain tax situation and budget situation that we're in? And Mr. West, this question for you first.
Well, luckily, like I said, I drive about 200 miles a day on these roads, and they're not very good. Wildwood Road, the bridge has been out for 6 months. I know that it's not we're funded from a gas tax. And so and they've kind of taken the political side out of it. County commissioner pretty much makes all decisions for this. With our state highways, it's a safety issue, and who wants to come to Oklahoma when the roads are jumping? So, you know, people cry out, we don't want the money from the federal government, but they sure want to get the federal government for the roads and highways. And so I think we need to take a serious look at our infrastructure. And I'm not saying we need to raise taxes. We don't have the tax basis to do that. Can you repeat the last part of the meeting?
Well, the question is, how should the legislature approach the improvement of our tunnels, roads, and bridges?
But we need to make it. We need to make it important. I don't know specifically. It's hard to make, like I say, without getting there and looking at the true numbers. I don't know. I can sit up here and tell you guys stuff all day, but I need to see true numbers and how it actually works.
Mr. Russell, same question.
Actually, out talking to people, this is people's biggest complaint is the roads in Delaware County. They said all the roads, I mean, you really can't drive on a road, a county road, especially without hitting a pothole in the road. Solutions on fixing it is a county commissioner issue. Like I said, 50 cents of the tax goes to fix the roads. But it's hard to say we just need to put more money in it because, you know, our state's going broke. We have no money for education. We have no money for this. So, you know, we're asking how to fix the problem. And the answer is more money, but there is no money. One thing we could do is probably figure out where the money's going and kind of hold the county commissioner a little more hold them responsible for the funds that are used and figure out what's going on with that, whether we do an audit of the commissioner's office. And that would be a start.
Going to the University of Arkansas, there were some embarrassing times. One of them was saying I was from Oklahoma. They look at me and say, you know, I always know when I'm in the state of Oklahoma, not because of the sign, because of that first pothole that I hit. To make anything better, you make it a priority. Anything, whether it's public education, the DHS, anything. To make something better, you make it a priority. What the state and the local level has yet to do is make a priority of what they think deserves what money. Right now across the state, all public entities are getting cut at the knees. Instead of going in surgically and looking at what we can remove waste from without hurting everyone. It's clear that the state does not have priorities and we need to start making them.
Next question will go to Mr. Russell.
The Grand River Waterway is pretty important to us here. How much importance would you place on protecting the Grand River watershed?
Grand River Waterway?
The watershed, all the lakes.
Okay.
You can feed into Grand Lake.
Well, it's very important. You talk about like pollution or just protecting in general or
the whole.
Okay.
I want to hear what your thoughts are.
Okay. Well, I think it's very important since this is where we live and Grand River, by the way, it provides you drinking water to boat, provides drinking water, but also tourism. Our lake is a huge draw to outside people from other states, and it brings a lot of tourism for this area. And that's one thing we need to do is put our money, which I guess we don't have, but but anyways, we need to put our resources and priority into preserving the lake and infrastructure around the lake to be able to draw people in and bring in tourism.
Grand Lake is the number one asset for Northeast Oklahoma. We have to take care of it. We have to make sure that we take care of our number one asset. I just took a tour recently with Senator Littlefield at Simmons. Simmons, when I was growing up, was a very, very hot topic. It was looked upon badly. And I didn't realize it had changed until 2 weeks ago. I took a tour of the waterway, the waste going into the Grand River. It's phenomenal. They go above and beyond to make sure that water system is taken care of. We have to make sure that it stays like that for the coming decades. Otherwise, if we don't take care of our number one asset, we're going to start losing tourism. We're going to start losing money in Northeast Oklahoma.
I I'd say this has been a real hot topic for me since I decided to run, because I work for Simmons, and usually I've been asked many times, so are we going to be married to Simmons? And so, you know, my answer has always been is no, you know, I'm not going to support something that would harm my kids. I live on the lake, I live at a work hauler, so, you know, I got to swim in that stuff, I'm downstream. My brother has about a half a mile of Honey Creek on his farm, and so like Joseph was saying, you know, that Simmons spent millions and millions of dollars to change their wastewater treatment facility. At any time, you guys have heard of this. They were over-mandated by every federal and government agency you can think of, and they're heavily fined if they're out of ordinance. And so, yeah, I'm not going to support anything that's going to harm our watershed. It is very important. Like I said, this is the jewel of Northeast Oklahoma, and we have to take care of it. And it's one of the greatest natural resources in this part of the state. So, thank you.
Question from our audience, I think, is a great question. Where does the Oklahoma legislature, and more importantly, where would you stand on calling for an article convention of the states? And what is your opinion on an article to call a convention of the states? And that goes to Mr. West.
You want to ask me that question?
You want me to ask
it? Well, yeah, you can ask it, but I'm not going to answer it. What do you got?
Well, I'm trying to read it the way it's written. Where does the Oklahoma legislature currently stand on the article of convention for the states, in other words, to readdress the Constitution, the article of convention, and what is your opinion on it?
I don't know, Robert. I heard. Maybe I'm not hearing it right, but I don't know what my opinion is. Can you re-clarify?
Yeah. Who wrote this question?
Won't you stand up and
The Article 5 Convention of the States. For the states to be
able to
change the United States,
an Article 5 Convention.
If two-thirds of the states vote to have a convention to discuss the Constitution, it takes two-thirds of the states to do so. It requires each state legislature to vote to do that. Once we do that, then it would open up the Constitution for discussion under the article.
We're talking about changing state constitutions or federal
constitutions? It's the federal constitution.
Well, I think that, you know, the Constitution was made up of 8,000 years of history, and they took the best things and the worst things out of history and when it was written. So, you know, I don't think anything to change the Constitution right now. So. No, I don't
say you would be against that.
Yeah, I'd be against it.
I personally love the Constitution of the United States of America, and personally that's why I'm doing what I'm doing, and that's why I served and fought in the Marine Corps. So I would be against changing it in any way. Like I said before, I think that's, if we start messing with the fundamentals that make us who we are and what we are, it opens up to, I mean, who how do we know what's going to be changed to? So I'm against it.
While I understand the Constitution was framed by some magnificent people 240 years ago, it was also changed 27 times. I'm not advocating that we change anything right now, at all. What I am proponent of is intellectual conversation. I'm okay talking about some things, but to make sure that we keep to what the framers did back in 1787.
So, to be clear, you would be okay with the legislature voting to approve the discussion to have Oklahoma be considered as one?
I would be okay to see what the people of Oklahoma would want.
Okay. Gentlemen, we have about 5 minutes left. I want to give you time for your summaries. But I want to ask a fun question. We haven't asked any fun questions. They've all been fun to me, but that doesn't mean I didn't have to answer them. If you could have dinner, who gets to go first?
Mr. Russell.
Mr. Russell. question is, if you could have dinner with one of the framers of the Constitution, who would that be and why? Yes. Don't ask me to listen.
I know, there's so many of a documentary of how the Constitution was formed, and there's so much history of it. What was that one that was in Monroe, Rebecca, that I just looked up to him because so many of them did so many things, but he was the one that really stood out to me of what he did. So that's probably who I would choose to have dinner with.
Is that Marilyn or James?
James.
Mr. Miller.
He's a joke in this song, isn't it? James Madison. He was considered the father of the Constitution. He was 36 years old. I'm 27, and I'm up here doing this. I put my neck on the line because I firmly believe in the power of education. And I'm not doing half of what James Madison did 240 years ago. For him to be considered the father of the Constitution at 36, I wouldn't even begin to know what kind of questions I would ask him. I would ask why. It would be an amazing sit down with the father of the Constitution.
Thomas Jefferson. I don't have a reason why, just because it would be a cool thing. You know, we talk about the Constitution, there's some people that sit around and talk about the Constitution. Well, I believe in the Constitution. I've fought and I've bled and I've seen my brothers die in the name of the Constitution. So, there's a lot of people that bash people, and it's easy to sit around and watch Fox News and attend meetings and think you're political savvy. I'm not political savvy, but I want to serve. And so, all those guys served. The main reason I'm doing this is to serve. And so, I would still like Ron Wayne too. So.
For the record, he was not one of the framers of the Constitution. But I do think he was around at the time. We are to your closing comments. Before we ask you to give your closing comments, I want to thank the three of you for your willingness to serve. When I took on this role and responsibility for the county, it's a remarkable opportunity, but I was told that one of the toughest things I would have is finding quality people to run for office. That has not been the case in Delaware County. You are all three, and because we've been able to get to know each other so well, I am very proud to call each and every one of you friend. And I'm honored for the service that you provide and for the efforts that you go through. And couldn't be more proud of the way you've handled yourself this evening. So thank you for your service and for your willingness to serve. This is not easy what they had to do this evening. So we thank you for that very much. I will call now for the closing of your summary words. Comments, we will go in the inverse order because we're starting. So, Mr. West, you will go first. Mr. Wilhelm, and then Mr. Russell, you will close.
Hey, thanks for having us, Robert. Thank you all for attending and listening to us. Joseph and Josh, I appreciate you guys too. Like Robert said, it's not easy. It's not easy to put yourself out there. There are three guys who want to serve. And so, when it comes down to making your decision, I think you should. Well, don't judge me based on this, I promise you. I'm not the best speaker, but I promise you that I've got the heart of a servant, and I think I'm going to win this primary, this dude, not based on my consultant, not based on my answers to these questions tonight, not based on it. I'm probably not even the nicest person ever, but I've worked hard. I think it showed. I've hit every precinct in this district. I started knocking doors back in August. I talked to thousands and thousands of people, and
I can't tell you how many people said that, you know what, no one has ever came by our house, Josh, and talked to us. And that's, so that's where I've done well with the general public, and I like seeing that. And so I hope you can relate that to, well, you know, these guys have all worked hard, but, you know, maybe Josh likes to read the bills before he signs it. And so thanks for having me, Sir Robert. I'm ready to go take this jacket off and sweat to death, so thank you, guys.
Thank you to everyone for coming out and supporting each three of us. This has not been an easy thing for any of us. When I look across this crowd, I know that Northeast Oklahoma, despite its woes in education, has a phenomenal education program. I see kids out here. When I was 16, 17 years old, the last thing I would be doing is sitting at a political debate. So thank you to those kids for being out here, just for your general interest and knowledge of wanting to know more and wanting to help. So thank you to them. And this has been a very, very humbling experience for me to be 27 years old and look out and see people who have way more life experience than me. And they tell me, I'm proud of you. Thank you for doing this, and I'd love to support you. So I hope that through tonight, I have been able to work for some of your support. If not, I hope to continue to work for that support, and hopefully I'll see some of you out soon.
Well, I think politics is an interesting thing, because I found out one thing about politics is when you're running for an office, you want to find out as many things that are wrong with the state and as you can. And once you get elected, you want to find out as many things that are right with it. So that's one thing I've noticed about sitting politicians is that. But 2016 is going to be a pivotal year, not only for our country, but for the state of Oklahoma. Like we've talked about, we have a $1 billion deficit. We can't fund our education system. We have a weak economy. These are some things that, if elected, I will work as hard as I can to try to fix and do everything I can to fix the state of Oklahoma. Thank you.
You guys know when the primary is going to be held? June the 28th, you have a tough choice to make. We're asking you to make sure that you go vote. These men are working hard for your vote. They're going to continue to work hard for your vote. They got a lot more doors to knock, a lot more phone calls to make. They need your support. Now, one of them asked not for your money, but they could probably use a few dollars here and there to help with signs and some of the things that they need to do. It costs money to run a campaign. Thank you so much for being here this evening. Thank you all for putting up with a really bad moderator. I'll try to get better next time. I'm a Baptist preacher, what do you expect? Didn't ask for a collection plate.
Next time.
Couldn't do it because I had another Baptist preacher here. We'd have fought over the money. The next 5 weeks are critical. We are at a crossroads in our nation. And we can talk about the national politics, we can talk about the state politics, but let me tell you, change starts right here. It starts with these men, one of which is going to become the Republican candidate for the November primary, for the general election. And let me tell you a little bit about his opponent. His opponent, up until a couple years ago, decided he was a Republican. Now he's a Democrat. So we have something to run on with him. My job, once we have a candidate, is to do everything we can to rally behind our nominee. And I will call on both the other two candidates to do everything we can to support the candidate going forward. And we need to pull together to make sure that we keep this seat as a Republican seat. That's our job. They've done their job tonight. I want to give them another round of applause tonight. Thank you for coming. And thank you all for coming tonight. Be safe. It looks like there's no rain, so you're good.
Thank you.
And by the way, if you have any, these guys are going to be at their tables. So if you have any questions, you want to talk to them. And I, we,